Good evening. Thanks for coming out tonight. This is an important night for all of us at TCM, and I hope for you as well. Because tonight we are celebrating the legacy of TCM host Robert Osborne. Robert advocated for this festival for years. He loved this festival when it got going, and he loved this community of people sharing in the magic of the movies. At the 2018 TCM Classic Film Festival, we inaugurated the Robert Osborne Award to recognize those who have helped keep classic films prescient and relevant for future generations. That first year, of course, the award went to Martin Scorsese, followed by Kevin Brownlow and Leonard Maltin, who was here tonight, and that happened in this very theater last year. This year's honoree, Donald Bogle, has spent the better part of the last half century last night, I introduced Steven Soderbergh and George Clooney, and the amount of applause, it took a second for people to applaud George Clooney's name, the Donald Bogle name, the applause happened quicker. You scored one over George Clooney. This year's honoree, Donald Bogle, spent the better half of the last half century shining a light on the influence black artists have had on screen since the dawn of this medium. Over the course of my 20 years here at TCM, I've gotten to know a lot of people well, a lot of people who we interview well. I've spoken multiple times to like Angie Dickinson, who was here on opening night, and to Eva Marie Saint, and to Tippi Hedren, and Norman Lloyd, and Mel Brooks. But I think, Donald, that it is entirely possible that the person I've interviewed the most is you, which makes me very happy. Because every time you interview Donald, you learn something you didn't know. Donald offers a perspective that just nobody else can. And our friendship grew out of our shared love of Dorothy Dandridge and our shared appreciation of Ivan Dixon. Donald first appeared on Turner Classic Movies back in 2006 as Robert's co-host for TCM's 38-film series Race and Hollywood, which traced the depictions of African Americans in Hollywood from the silent era all the way into the 1980s. Plus, his most recent book for TCM, Hollywood Black, has just been picked up as a docuseries at MGM Plus. So, of course, all of you are going to want to keep an eye out for that. Before we bring up our special guests and ultimately Donald himself, though, we're going to take a quick look at Donald's incredible impact on film history. Wow, learned a couple of things there. Donald looks exactly the same as he did 30 years ago, and he also has not bought a new pair of glasses in 30 years. We have a couple of speakers here who know Donald well. First, I'd like to welcome to the stage a producer who's run production companies for Denzel Washington and Whitney Houston. She produced a couple of movies that are very relevant to me, Princess Diaries and its sequel. Very important films for a certain 10-year-old girl in my household. Deborah Martin Chase, also the first female producer to ever have a deal at a major studio. Please welcome her to the stage.
I always refer to my dear friend Donald as the foremost historian of Black Hollywood. And as such, I cannot think of anyone who is more deserving of the Robert Osborne Award. Donald and his impressive body of work have met the standard of the award, obviously, to keep alive the spirit of classic films. But his impact, as we see in this movie, has been so much more on Hollywood, so much more profound, because he has dedicated his life's work to making sure that the achievements of Black cinema artists and the blood, sweat, and tears that they have poured into Hollywood since its very inception are documented, honored, and respected. Most film historians analyze what's on screen and interpret it, and Donald certainly has done that work. But he has examined, analyzed, and preserved the personal lives, struggles, and triumphs of the artists that collectively form Black Hollywood. And I really believe that without Donald Bogle, the real history of Black Hollywood would have been forgotten and lost. In the introduction to his book, Hollywood Black, Donald states the real truth that, quote, Blacks made a place for themselves in an industry that had no place for them. Tinseltown is a land of dreams and aspirations. And as this audience knows, it was founded for the most part by European and Russian immigrants who came to America in search of a better life, and they projected their idealized version of their adopted country onto the screen. Well, that version did not include Blacks, or for that matter, most people of color, in anything but subservient, diminished, and even demonized roles. Nevertheless, we too had celluloid dreams, and we made the journey to Hollywood to try and make them come true. The real tragedy of racism and discrimination is that it prevents its victims from fulfilling their true potential, from utilizing all of their talents and skills to take them as far as they would carry them naturally. And historically in Hollywood, often, determined and talented Black artists would break through a barrier and achieve a milestone, only to find that on the other side, there were no more opportunities that for meaningful career advancement. There were artists like Madame Sute Wan, the first Black actress to sign a film contract and to be a featured performer. Noble Johnson, the first Black leading man, who along with actor Clarence Brooks founded Lincoln Motion Picture Company, which was the first production company to make movies with positive images of Blacks. Nina Mae McKinney, dubbed the Black Garbo, who was the first sex symbol leading lady, and so many more. Relatively speaking, their achievements were huge and impactful for Black Hollywood, but they weren't considered big enough for white Hollywood to really take notice and to embody them in the history of the industry. Today, but for Donald's meticulous research and compelling and captivating books, these pioneers would be forgotten. All of their hard work, their triumphs, their tragedies, and their toils would just disappear. Donald and I met and bonded in 1997 around one of his greatest achievements, the resurrection, and it really was a resurrection, of the importance, the beauty, and the awesomeness of Dorothy Dandridge through his acclaimed biography. My father was the biggest film and television buff that I ever knew. My brother's sitting out here, he can attest to it. I grew up in that household where we watched movies and we watched TV. But that's until I met Donald, who, like, you know, knows everything. I had grown up with a deep appreciation of Hollywood history. I had seen Carmen Jones. I understood the gloriousness of Dorothy Dandridge. So when I heard about the publication of Donald's definitive biography, I was really interested. And furthermore, I had just started a partnership with Whitney Houston, and we had a production company at Disney, and I thought that the role could be something great for her. It was love at first sight between Donald and I. I know we recognized kindred spirits who understood Hollywood history, who respected it, and who also wanted to make sure that there were changes going forward in the business. We set out to try to make a great biographical movie about Dorothy. When we started our journey, there were very few people who remembered her, and really nobody in white Hollywood. But we initially set the movie up at Disney. There was great fanfare, a lot of publicity. We even organized a Dorothy retrospective at Film Forum in New York, which Donald hosted and moderated. Along the way, Donald introduced me to some of the most fabulous people of older Black Hollywood. We had dinner with Harold Nicholas, the extraordinary dancer, who was Dorothy's first husband. We spent many, many hours with the glorious Jerry Branton, and we would pick up soul food at a little place on Crenshaw that she loved, and we would go to her house in Lafayette Square, and we would just sit in the den, which was her room, and for hours she would just tell us stories about Dorothy and all the other fabulous people that she had come up with. Ultimately, Hollywood was not ready to make a period motion picture about a Black female entertainer at that time. But undoubtedly, Donald's book, his love of Dorothy, his determination to bring her back into the zeitgeist, and the positive publicity that we generated around our attempts to do this motion picture helped Hallie get her television movie made at HBO. I sent Hallie flowers when she won the Emmy, and she called me to thank me. And we agreed that Dorothy was smiling brightly and that she was thankful and proud of Hallie, Donald, and me for bringing her, for giving her the attention, the place in history that she wasn't able to do on her own. Donald, you call me, and it's Deborah, darling. And so today I'm calling you Donald, darling. I know how much this means to you. This is the culmination, really, of all of your work to date. And I know there's so much more that you are going to do and contribute to Hollywood and to the world. And now that there's finally a recognition in Hollywood, finally, of the value of diversity, the entire industry is indebted to you for single-handedly preserving the real history of Black Hollywood. I stand here right now, and I know I'm surrounded by the spirit of all the Black artists whose legacies you have preserved. And we are all saying, thank you, Donald.
That was beautiful. Thank you, Deborah. Our next speaker, another great friend, Donald's, known to us as an actor of uncommon range and singular intensity. He's also an Oscar winner for An Officer and a Gentleman, great friend to TCM. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lou Gossett, Jr.
Let's try that again. You didn't mean it. What a privilege. What a privilege to be here now, after all these years, and to see old friends. See them grow up, and it's so much better than working, you know that? See people coming out of the woodwork on airplanes and stuff, and getting handshakes and hugs from old friends. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart, and thank you, Mr. Bogle. That's why I'm here. We do a lot of things in common, you know, having won the Oscar after Sydney. Then I had to find out my agents went, what's left to do? So I started the research that Mr. Bogle had started. Even before that, we do the same thing. So we have the same history, because I wanted to do some of the stories of Bats Reeves. I found out the Amistad and the stories of Kwame Nkrumah and Lumumba and people like that. And then I got to see who Rex Ingram was, and Donald will tell you who that was. And then there was all kinds of Sidney Poitier who I followed, and James Edwards, Rex, and then Frank Silvera. He knew about them all, so we have something in common. I'm thinking from the bottom of my heart about that interview he did in depth at on YouTube, on Turner Classic thing. But that man, Mr. Bogle, is one of the, what do you want to call it, the strength, the concrete of our history, which is needed for all of us to know about. We're coming to the place where we are needed desperately. Our community of all races and all colors need to drop all our agendas and join together as one people, one nation, under God, indivisible, for the salvation of us all. So thank God for Mr. Bogle. All the people that we have in common and memories of a fondness of the Bats Reeves and the Paul Robeson. Paul Robeson was a friend who adopted me when I was 17. 1953, the new kid on the block. And Paul Robeson got tickled about this new kid because finally there's somebody new on Broadway. So he'd shake my hand and his fingers would go to my elbows. I was 17 years old. He'd come backstage and go, So my great grandmother, and we have a photograph that I talked to Don about it, 17 years old, 1953. Do the math quickly. My great grandmother comes in and says, get out the way. So she comes out the way and I said, oh, Grandma, you came to see the play, and she slapped me in the face 5 times. I said, Grandma, why'd you slap me? She slapped me again. Now, Paul is kind of mirroring the whole thing. He's kind of worried. She says, I saw you sassed your grandma up there, and I taught you better than that. Paul Robeson is in stitches. I'm doing a play with the late Frederick O'Neill, Estelle Hemsley, the Evans, Maxine Sullivan. All these people are in Mr. Bogle's book. And thank God I am also. So God works in very mysterious ways, y'all. There's no accidents for being here now, after over 70 years of service to you, which I'm very grateful for, to be able to get up on these steps with or without a wheelchair and say thank you from the bottom of my heart for the contributions of Mr. Bogle has saluted us. And back at you, we love you back. We've only just begun, because now we have become one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice. Oh, what you said, look what you said. Love you madly, thank you.
Well, this is great, two microphones, sort of a dream come true for me, finally. Ladies and gentlemen, you didn't come here for anything except this, really, in the end. I would like to welcome to the stage to present the 4th annual Robert Osborne Award to Donald Bogle.
Thank you very much. Earlier this evening, I was talking to Leonard Maltin. And as you know, Leonard was the recipient of the Osborne last year. And I said, well, Leonard, I'm a little bit nervous. I said, how did you feel about it? And he said, Donald, it was overwhelming. And I sort of have that feeling now. I did not want to see that tribute to me. But actually, I enjoyed it, except for one photograph. And Jacob Griswold did a great job on it. I made a little list. There are just some people I do want to thank, and I don't want to forget them. The Osborne Award means so much to me for various reasons. One was because, as you saw, I worked with Robert Osborne. I was on the air with him. And I can remember in the beginning when I first met him, I didn't know what to expect, but he was very gracious and very helpful and very kind. And I sat and I was just really stunned by his knowledge of the movies, of productions, of things that happened before the movies were made, during the process of filmmaking and afterwards. He was just phenomenal. And Robert also had really the ideal television persona. Marshall McLuhan has told us that television is a cool medium. And Robert was very, very cool. He was always just reassuring, and as you sat there watching him, you just wanted to listen, and you appreciated the knowledge and the very direct, accessible way in which he gave it to you. Now, the other reason this is so important is that, frankly, as I wrote these books and as I did other things, I never thought of it as even a career. I never thought of it as a body of work. I just knew there were things I wanted to explore and discover and understand for myself. And I felt always that there was this history that was not being observed, not being understood, not being documented. And I have to say that with this award, I feel that, well, maybe I did do something right. Maybe I did more than I realized. Now, I'm going to introduce Carmen Jones, but first I do want to thank a few people because TCM, they welcomed me in right after I appeared with Robert. I've done other number of appearances on TCM. And I can remember I was told right away, you're a member of the family. And so there's certain family members, and I really can't thank them all. That's what makes me feel terrible because of time restraints. But there's some I've got to let you know about. I want to thank Pola, who is the general manager and keeps TCM going. I want to thank Ben, who I've just enjoyed immensely working with. Ben knows that sometimes I do go on, and Ben says to me, but you always come right back to the point. And he's terrific to work with. I want to thank Genevieve McGillicuddy, who I met when I first went to Atlanta to film sequences, and she was so welcoming and really made me feel at home. I also want to thank Darcy Hedricks, who handled talent, and Darcy was just, she was so optimistic and made me feel, again, so welcomed. I want to thank Jean Franz, who is here tonight, who was at TCM in Atlanta when I first was being introduced to her by Darcy. Darcy said to me, Jean is a brilliant woman. And I got very nervous, this brilliant person I'm to meet. And I met her, and she is brilliant, but she's also very down to earth and very knowledgeable. And then I want to thank Charlie Tabish. And Charlie is the engine. I don't know, can't see him right now, and he doesn't like to hear this, but he is the engine that keeps things moving. These films you see, it's Charlie who programs them, and it's Charlie who will look for things that haven't been seen, and he discovers them. And Charlie is a really great friend of mine, and he's such a decent human being, and he's someone you can talk to anything about. I mean, politics, social events, sports, and film. And that friendship and association has meant so much to me. I want to thank Lou Gossett, who I just, you know, we all know An Officer and a Gentleman and his brilliance. I mean, he walks away with the movie. But, and we know him as Fiddler in Roots, an Emmy-winning performance. And I can't help pushing, even now, that you want to see The Landlord, a movie that he did with Diana Sands and Lee Grant, and which he has a powerful sequence in which he breaks down. And I've just never seen anything like it. And then I want to thank, really, my dear, dear friend, Deborah Martin Chase. And Deborah is someone, she is one of the few people I thoroughly enjoy discussing the movies with and discussing Hollywood. And Deborah also did Harriet, the Oscar-nominated film. And she's got a big hit with The Equalizer on television with Queen Latifah. And she has high standards, and I just, I do say sometimes, Deborah darling, and I do adore her. Now, I do want to tell you, as we get into the film that we're about to see, and I do have a time restraint, so you have to bear with me. We're going to see Carmen Jones, but I have to give you some backstory on Carmen Jones and what Carmen Jones meant to me when I saw it. I grew up in Pennsylvania, as you heard, and as a kid, I suffered from asthma. I had severe attacks, and my darling mother was more pained by my attacks than I think even I was, and I was pained. And she tried all sorts of treatments for me to, because when you have asthma, you're struggling to breathe, you're struggling for life. And she did all she could. And then on days when I couldn't go out to play, I was propped up in front of the TV set. And in those days, there was no TCM, but you could see old movies on TV, movies from the 30s and the 40s. And as I watched these old films, it might be Buck Benny Rides Again with Jack Benny, but also Eddie Rochester Anderson and Teresa Harris. There might be the Charlie Chan movies with Birmingham Brown, a character played by Mantan Moreland. Or it might be Saratoga, Jean Harlow's last film, in which she starred with Clark Gable and with Hattie McDaniel. When I saw these films, and as I think you understand, I didn't define these roles as stereotypes, but I knew something was wrong. And I appreciated the vitality of the actors and covert messages they were sending out. And I always wondered, and I even asked, where does Rochester go when he's not on screen? Where is Hattie McDaniel? I wanted the movie to be about them. And I didn't see it until one day I got to see Carmen Jones. Carmen Jones was directed by Otto Preminger in 1954. And it had been a hit and a historic film. The first black cast musical coming out of Hollywood since 1943, when they had been Cabin in the Sky and Stormy Weather, two classics today. And Preminger had done this film, and I got to see it. And I was just amazed by what was on screen. It was an all-star cast. There was Harry Belafonte, Pearl Bailey. There was Olga James, who we hoped would come tonight, who plays Cindy Lou. There was also Brock Peters, Roy Glenn. And there is a sequence in Carmen Jones, and you're going to see it. It's a little bit later in the film. It's still second act. And they're at a sort of a roadside club. And the characters, we see them relating to one another, and we see them dancing. And I had never seen such energy on screen. And Otto Preminger understood that energy, that vitality of his black performers as they relate it to one another. And in this sequence, you will see Carmen de Lavallade. She has the ponytail. Later, she was the prima ballerina with the Metropolitan Opera. You're going to see Archie Savage, who was with Catherine Dunham's dance troupe. And you're going to see the young Alvin Ailey. Pearl Bailey is going to sing, beat out that rhythm on a drum. And of course, this is based on Bizet's opera, Carmen. And who do we see on drums? Max Roach. And Preminger just knew this. And he wanted to give them a chance to relate to one another and to relate culturally, because they're operating at a different rhythm when they're operating in a black cast. Black cast drama or musical. And Otto understood that, and he went with it. But at the center of it was Dorothy Dandridge. And as a kid, when I watched it, I said to myself, whoever put this together was transfixed by this woman. And Otto was. and I was intoxicated by her. Now, I just want to tell you a bit about what Dorothy Dandridge does in this film, among many things. Dorothy Dandridge had to fight to get this role. Otto Preminger wouldn't even interview her in the beginning. She finally got to see him, and Preminger looked at her. He'd seen her in nightclubs. She was a big nightclub star. And Preminger said to her, "Miss Dandridge," and I can't get his accent right, I wish I could. He said, "Miss Dandridge, I don't see you as my Carmen. When I look at you, you're so sophisticated and elegant. You're Saks Fifth Avenue." He said, "Here, take this script. Go home, study the role of Cindy Lou, the good girl, and then come back and see me next week." Dorothy Dandridge was very polite. She left. She went home. She spoke to her older sister, Vivian, who was staying with her, and she was furious. She said, "How can he tell me I can't play Carmen? I'm going to do it." And Dorothy Dandridge, in that week, she went to Max Factor, she did her makeup over, she did her hair in a different way, she went in to see Preminger the next time, provocatively dressed, she had a rose in her hand. And as she came into the Preminger office, Otto said, "It's Carmen." And he wanted a screen test right away. Later he said it was the greatest screen test he'd ever seen. Dorothy Dandridge found something that she could connect to. But when she got the part, and I want you to think of it as you see this film, when she got it, and as she went through the script, she began to have doubts. She did not want Carmen to come across as one more loose black woman. And Dorothy Dandridge, who had studied at the Actors Lab here in California, very progressive acting school, she studied with Marilyn Monroe, with whom she was friendly. She really knew how to pick apart a script and a character. And she searched to find something in that script that she could use that would take her Carmen in a different direction. And she saw that Carmen was a woman who is seeking her own liberation. Carmen, as you're going to see tonight, she's in a world that's dominated by men. But she's not going to let that happen. She is assured throughout. And it is a real acting achievement because Dandridge herself was not a very secure woman. There's a pivotal scene in this movie I want you to watch. I tell my students this. You watch it carefully. There is a hotel room in Chicago. It's sleazy, downtrodden. And Harry Belafonte is with her, and he's being very possessive. And he says, "I love you. And that gives me the right," and she says, "It doesn't give you the right to own me." There's only one person who does. And follow the sequence through. There's not much more that happens, but it has power. Dandridge used that, and she gave us a Carmen who ultimately, even at the end, is not a victim. It is a woman determined to live on her own terms. And in movie terms, that kind of female independence has to be punished, and it has to be done away with. But she's triumphant even at the end. This is a historic film. Dorothy Dandridge became the first black performer to be nominated for an Oscar in a leading role. Hattie McDaniel had won a supporting Oscar for a great performance in Gone with the Wind, but Dorothy got that big award. I saw Carmen Jones, and that took me further in my search now to find movie images and to see other films, whether it was Oscar Michaud's or Spencer Williams, where we got to see black casts and black actors operating on a new rhythm and holding on to their cultural bearings. And so with that, you're going to have the chance. If you've seen it before, you're going to see it again. And here it is, that all-star cast, Belafonte, Olga James, 19-year-old Diane Carroll, Pearl Bailey, Max Roach, Alvin Ailey, Archie Savage, Carmen de Lavallade, Dorothy Dandridge, and Carmen Jones. Thank you.